Really, what we've been talking about is one of the things we've talked about from the very beginning, we may not have picked up on it, is we've been talking about priority, or first things first. First things first. First things first. And I truly believe that this is part of the dilemma of many Christians, is that they don't really understand that God is a God of order, and that God does have first things that must be first. Let's say they go to a church, and at the church that they're going to, they hear, say, one of the third things. But they hear that first. See what I'm saying? So they go, okay, well, this is it, then, because I heard this first. So it's understandable that many people get off. But one of the purposes of searching the scriptures is to begin to understand God's order, or what are first things, in order that they might be placed first, and then the secondary is second. That's why we said in is before all. Remember that, the first class that we had? In is before all. This is not just a cute little play on words. This is a spiritual principle. In is before all. Okay? How would a person know that? I would assume, not that the way I learned it is the only way, whatever, but that as you search the scriptures, the Holy Spirit begins to teach you, how do you say this? He doesn't teach you, he teaches you reality. That's the best way, and I know these are terms that I use a lot, but he teaches you reality. He doesn't teach you things. He teaches you reality. He teaches you that spirit, the spirit realm, the Lord, God is spirit, and spirit created this world. So spirit is before material. Spirit is before material. So to teach you things are material things. Okay? So to teach you things would mean that he is teaching out of order. The Holy Spirit is going to teach you spirit in order to understand the natural. Now you say, well, but doesn't the scripture say wasn't that which was first natural and then wasn't that which was spiritual? Yeah, as far as our understanding, as far as us entering into it, yes. But because we're thrown into a natural world, we live through so many years until we begin to come into the reality of the spirit. And because the old man, as far as man was concerned, was first, then the new man. And the scripture that talks about that, that's the example that it's given, by the way. So don't read that any other way. So this last class, we were talking about first things first. We talked about two things, and we tried to put them in order. We talked about a building, and we talked about a foundation. Now, to most anybody that looks at a building, building and foundation are one. That is what we call assumed. It is assumed. However, in priority of establishment, there is an order. Yes, they are one. A house and a foundation are considered one. But as far as which one you lay first, you should lay the foundation first. Okay. So, Jesus said in Matthew 16 that the foundation upon which he will build the church is the revelation of Christ. So to build the church without a revelation of Christ is not yet to truly build. Now that's a powerful thought. If you just literally took that, it would make you really, you know what I'm saying? But could there be some truth to that?
Rick? quite depth and they can build a foundation on it. There, I suggest once you build a foundation, you build your house, if you hold your house with foundations, that one doesn't shake. Your house is actually connected to the foundation, but it may still shake, but it doesn't, it's not going to fall off the foundation.
Right.
So you've got three steps.
Well, when I taught on foundation, there's a scripture that says, that talks about foundations. And then what you're talking about, there's a foundation, and then there's a foundation for the foundation. Right. The rock is the true foundation.
Right.
The foundation for the house is on the rock, and the house is on the foundation. And, you know, obviously, I'm not going to go into teaching that whole thing, but absolutely, absolutely. But you see, the revelation of Christ is upon this rock. It really is the foundation. I mean, there's just no question. Because it is, the word revelation means unveiling, that's all it means. You were just talking about unveiling the rock, or the foundation, or the. You see, I mean, we're just using terms, we're using words here. You know, a certain word may appeal to you, but they all have the same meaning. Foundation, rock, the. It's all the same. It is that which was before all things were made, which we call creation. And, you know, heaven and earth will pass away, but his word will not pass away. It's why? Because his word was before him. In fact, I think I put something about the church here, and I put, we're talking about first things first. And I put, what many put first is church or prayer. Church or prayer. But the church is not the beginning. The reason he is preeminent is the church began at the cross, but he didn't. He didn't begin at the cross. Not the new man did, but Jesus, the life of the new man, the foundation from which the new man can spring, did not begin at the cross. So that's why he is preeminent above the church. How to come?
Well, is it the revelation or the unveiling of Christ different from the tipping of the scales in your mind?
Yes, because one is, well, yes, yes, it is. Yeah, one is the renewing of the mind, and the other one is the revelation of Christ.
Well, because at a point, some point along the line in Revelation, you see, you have this in the beginning experience, which is at the beginning of Revelation.
It begins at Revelation that you begin to see this, but our minds are so dull.
Yeah.
And it's so hard to break through our. It's like a layer of flesh, is the way I always think of it. And that's why knowing is necessary until the scales are tipped.
Yeah, and then that, when the tipping of those scales occur, when you first recognize the face in the mirror, then that is the perceived beginning. But that's not the beginning of Revelation.
Yeah, it's not. And now, I believe it happens different. I don't believe there's really one set way, so that if I describe what happened to me, that everybody would have to say, well, I have to have that experience, because then that would be a linear thing. But I know that for me, there was a point where I felt like I began in Revelation, or the unveiling of Christ, that it was like, man, God just pulled back the veil for a second, and I saw everything, and then he shut it back, and then he began to teach me what I couldn't have contained in those 2 seconds. I mean, it was, you know, like I said, I know for a lot of people it may not be, you know, and then I realized we got down the road, and there are things I probably didn't see yet. But for years after that, he would bring me into something new, and he would remind me that you saw just a glimpse of this when I kind of went like this. But you see, it makes sense when you understand the, because to see Jesus is everything, but you need an explanation of him as everything. I know this can sound confusing, but if he is the bread, if he is just by getting saved, it's going to fulfill all that. Yeah. And just by having a glimpse of the, you know, it's like I've taught this, the I am. Okay, he is, I am this, I am that, I am this, I am that. Okay, to know, what we usually know is I am the bread. So we know him as bread. We know him as Savior. We know him as Lord. And we have a few of the I am parts of the being that we pick out and know him. But we don't know the I am. Because he is all of it. So we will forever, I would assume, he must be so big, and we will forever be, you know, experiencing revelation or uncertain need to. Now what we do is we have a revelation experience, if that be what it is, because some people, to me, I know some people, it was nothing more than inspiration, some illumination. But we have, if I can term it this way, we have a revelation experience, and I know people that have had a revelation experience and said, I've had the revelation of Christ, and now they're all living this totally wild, and, you know, like God, but, you know, they're going, well, I want Jesus. I'm the Son of God. Christ is my Lord. And he goes, where? Look, I know what I saw. Yeah. But knowing this, and this is why you enter into, we'll get into this in just a second, but I'll refer back to this when I say, you never leave it again. Did you have another comment?
No, I think we
can. Okay. Just along this line that might help you to see a little different. He was talking, the way Al put it was, he says, the revelation and then the tipping of the scales. Two other terms that you can apply to that is the mind of Christ. At least maybe glimpsing the mind of Christ, and then having your mind renewed to the mind. Two different things. A lot of people, maybe even around here, have seen some things. I tell you, until those scales are tipped, you know, you need to continue until, you know, I believe it's like the path of the righteous is like the new day. The further you walk into it, the brighter the sun should get. Now, this doesn't mean that you're not going to have problems and something like that. This is talking about one specific area of truth. For me, I truly believe that this path has been, the further I walk into it, the brighter he's gotten, the greater he's gotten, and the greater I appreciate him to be. But I must say that at one juncture, when I began to understand by the Spirit of God what I was dealing with, I had dropped into a whole other reality of Christ that I couldn't even believe. I mean, my understanding was, there was my life and I was trying to fit him in the best I could. And when I saw what I saw, it blew me away. It didn't just kind of affect me. Maybe this is just my experience. Maybe most people are supposed to kind of go slowly wake up or whatever. Maybe they're really, I mean, that could actually be, all I can tell you is what happened to me. Man, I knew this was it, and I said, there ain't nothing else. I mean, I saw it, so it was like, I didn't see it forever and have it all, but it was, he was everything, and I realized that this is truth, the truth, and I said, there's nothing else to live for. Everything else is a shadow. Everything else is, at best, a shadow. And then, oh my God, they just took all, everything out of, it took all meaning out of the shadows. And I knew that the pathway must be through the veil as the Spirit of God would open my eyes to see Jesus. And then I knew that I would be able to live as best I could make it according to the pattern. So I'm down here making it according to the pattern that I've seen in the mountain. Many people are trying to get God to shoot stuff down from the mountain, you know, like Ten Commandments, you know, a scroll, one with one commandment on it, and we walk by that for 6 months or 6 years, you know what I mean? Go, okay, good word there, good one, Lord. You know what I mean? Instead of being caught up in the spirit realm reality, that dictating life down here, but to some degree we have all experienced that, because you've seen something of the Lord that has changed how you relate to people, or how you talk, or how you, you know what I mean? There are areas that you have seen something that it's changed the way, and you probably always be changed in those areas. Sure.
And that's what I was going to say, because talking to people, they have seen things.
Mm-hmm.
But also talking to different people, they think that the revelation of Christ is something that comes in a moment, in the blink of an eye.
Right.
Yes. that's what they see is a process of the revelation of Christ. I don't know how, maybe my terminology might be a little wrong when I say this, but they are in the revelation of Christ. They are in the process of the revelation of Christ. And one day, then all of these things that they've seen, even though they're disjointed, it's still the Lord here and still the Lord there, and it's disjointed. One day it will all be one, instead of just different things that they've seen.
Yeah, that's good, because that's what we're trying to do right now, is make this transition from end to be. I mean, last class we just stepped into him. Okay, but now we're in, but we haven't found him as the full sum total of what it's all about. We're in, and we are learning about the, but we haven't gotten to where it's just the. Okay. And I just actually repeated what you just said. I just put it in a little bit different way. And so, and you know, and to be honest with you, some of the scriptures that God used were these right here. And I'm going, my God, I mean, I'm reading in the beginning, and I'm seeing some of the things I'm sharing with you, and I'm reading it out of John, and I'm going, and I'm seeing the vastness of this, and I'm going, I don't even understand the Bible. I mean, I haven't even, I'm just barely getting to the place where I can understand in and the. I mean, that's what happened to me. I'm going, I am so far now. I mean, if you ever felt you're far behind, I was just going, and I'm working towards me. I mean, it scared me. Because it was like, and I was seeing the vastness of Ian. Well, how great must be me? And it was just going, ever since I was going, oh my God, I mean, you know, this is, no wonder it's going to take eternity. But I didn't realize how fast the Holy Spirit can work if we, you know, to he that understands will be given more. The scriptures say that. And it comes easy to those that understand. It's getting through that initial veil. It's like standing there looking at the veil with all the, you know, the veil. God was on the other side of the veil. God. Okay, but here they got these angels with beautifully woven intricacies. And, you know, it's got all this stuff, and it's got, you know, beautiful. Have you ever read on the veil all the work, the embroidery work? It was beautiful with angels and everything. And I can just see us standing there going, man, you know, gold tapestry, gold fine linen and gold and all this stuff, you know, and looking at it and just marveling, oh, man, this is a wonder of the handiwork of man for God. You know, and I can just see us sitting there going, wow, just going, you know, this is really special, you know, and all of a sudden the veil being rent and the presence of God, ah! And that was what I was experiencing as the Lord began to lead me just to him. Lead me in, you know, headed toward me. You know, and I'm going, my Lord, I mean, how do you explain this to somebody? You know what I mean? Imagine if you were sitting there doing that, looking at the veil and the thing was rent, and all of a sudden you saw God's presence and you have every right to enter in. And you went out and tried to explain that to somebody. You know. And they hadn't even seen the veil. They're looking at the badger skin or something. You know what I mean? You know? And we're just going, I mean, even the veil even said, man, it was so meticulous. You know, in God, it's just like, and they're going, you know, can't you say anything? Don't you know anything? You know, and you're going, thee! You know, and they're going, well, you're deaf and dumb, aren't you? Well, what happened to Zechariah when he was in the temple and praying to God? Couldn't talk, he was dumb. You know? He just did, and he just going, you know, what was funny is that he's in there serving God, doing his duties, and God shows up in form of an angel, and he freaks out. Ah! The angel says, don't be afraid. You know, this is really, you know, this temple stuff that you're doing is really just a shadow. The real stuff just showed up. He's going, ah! 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 Instead of going, cool, this is it! You know, it's like, I'd rather go through the motions dealing with the shadows. I have more security. I can feel the shadows. I can understand them. But you get in the presence of me, and it is, there's no more, you know, mind blowing. You know, I mean, it changes you. Do you see, the scripture said that as we look into the scripture and see him, we are changed from glory to glory. And it changes you, but the first thing is it does, for me anyway, and once again, you can't go by my experience, but the thing that it did for me was it took any vestige of thinking that, you know, well, if you build a big thing and you make a big ministry and, you know, I mean, like I said, V was before the church. You know what I mean? I mean, V was before prayer, because you got to pray to V, you know? And you're just going, it just, in that reality, truly, you see it, you just go, there's only one purpose in life, and that's to know thee, and hope it manifests, and probably will in a lot of different ways, and people will look at the way it manifests and go, oh, brother, and you're going, no, oh, brother, you know, and they say, well, you're just a carpenter's son. You go, yeah, I'm a son of God. I've seen the reality. And, you know, well, who do you think you are trying to teach us? Do you think you're better than us? They said to Jesus, oh, so you're the Son of God, huh? You know, blasphemy! He said, no, I know the Father. You don't. You know, I am thee. And all they could see was the veil of flesh. You know, seeing very peculiar. Well, didn't matter. He still was V. And as people's eyes, after V was crucified and rose from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the universe, you know, on, over the whole of creation and spiritual realm, those who had their eyes open saw V and come to worship and follow him. And those who haven't continue to mock and live in the world and spurns him and says, you know, hey, you guys are stupid doing without, you know. You could have this and that and this and that. And you go, you have no clue. But the disciples at one stage, they didn't really know a thing yet. That hadn't revealed. And they said, well, you know, Jesus, we've given up this, that, and that. What are we going to give? You know, it was like following Jesus is learning what it means to be willing to sacrifice. Following thee is everything. There is no purpose for anything else, you know. And if you end up sacrificing, you're doing it because you're after thee. And you see that is more valuable, you know, but Jesus put it this way. Let me give you a little parable. If you found the treasure in a field, and you knew that the treasure wasn't yours, it belonged to the other person who owned the field, and the only way to get the treasure was to buy the field, you buy the whole stinking field so that you can have the treasure. So you buy the good with the bad. You know. But you're not going on. Hey, look, have you ever noticed how many weeds are on this property? You know, or people come up to you and go, man, I tell you what, you're a good man. But you would sacrifice your good money for this. You're going, there's treasure here. There's treasure. There's treasure to me. And they say, well, you guys have such good virtues. You know, you're going, you don't even know virtue. We ain't B. In light of B, we are, you know, ungodly, but we are following him because he's everything. How do you explain? explain that stuff, you know, but mixed in with the followers of thee, you have those who, like, you know, the cross represents sacrificing and a good, honest way of life. You know, and they hear things taught along those lines around you. And so they go, yes, that's admirable. And I would like to have my life count for something in a good way. You know, and that's really good until the cross is something that they don't like and they haven't seen to be, they'll throw it down. And that's a fact. But when you are truly a follower of me, then you don't see those things. They don't have the impact on you. I can't say you don't see them. They don't have the impact on you, the feel and that you bought. What's wrong with you? Realize that that's not it anyway, that this is it. So you're not all concerned that there's junk, you know? Then you know that's not it. But people who don't know say, well, you bought the field must be it. And so they go, well, if the field is it, we've got to do something about this here field. You know, we got to get after fixing this thing. You know, and don't you see the need of the field? This ought to be, if this is God's field, this ought to be the best looking field on the block. And you're just going, if you only see the treasure, yeah, it wasn't a treasure, it wasn't the treasure. If you'd only seen the pearl of great price, not a pearl, this was the pearl, you wouldn't even care what the field looked like. That's not where you're intending. That you may have to live there, but that ain't what it's about. And you don't get all wrapped up in that. And people that, you know, try to put you down and go, oh man, you know, you don't go, oh, I've got to live according to the Joneses and I've got to have the same standards and stuff that they've got and they're putting pressure on me, so I've got to conform to what everybody, you go, look, I've seen them. I know what it's about. I'm sorry this doesn't please you or make you happy. And I realize that you came from Brother So-and-so's field over there in that denomination and joined us, and you think we're just like that. But it ain't. There's something that is buried here that's hid from the natural sight that we're excavating. And it's called thee. And they're going, okay, you know, because you're sincere. Well, that's good to see a sincere preacher. And then you go, look, how do you say this? How do you communicate this to somebody? You go, look, anything that I am, still ain't it. I'm after the thee. So that if they put you down or they lift you up, you've seen thee and you've seen yourself in light of thee, and you go, you know, they go, you dirty rat. You go, you don't even know. I wish you were here when I saw the bee. I mean, oh, you don't even know. You thank you for being kind to me. And when they start lifting you up and you're looking at me, you go, well, you know, I appreciate your love and whatever. This is it. Let me point you to Jesus. And if it's somebody trying to flatter you, it just rolls off. And that may be hard for some to believe, but it just rolls off like water on the duck's back. Right? I mean, I just believe that. Because when you seem to be, it would have to. You know, if you're talking about something else, but I'm talking about this, that's when it rolls off. When you seem the beginning, and they try to flatter you, you ain't sucked in any way, shape, or form. You're going, you know, you know, it's either thank you very much for your sincerity or look stupid. You need to see Jesus, because I ain't nothing. And like I drew this huge thing and then I drew our little life, I mean, it's even smaller than that. The significance of him is everything, and you've seen it and you know it. And you don't have to see it every day. I mean, it reverberates through your being. This is it. There is none other. He is he that was, and is, and is to come. Where are you going, brother? The beginning? Why? Because the beginning is the end, too. Jesus said, I am the beginning and the end. The beginning is Alpha, the end is Omega, and he is Alpha and Omega. Where are you going, brother? To know the Lord. Well, what are you doing in the process? As I see him, I find that I'm being conformed into that same image, and I find that I want to reach out. Jesus touched, ministered, helped. He helped people and turned their back on him. He helped Judas, and Judas betrayed him. Judas was a son of perdition, and you never find him mistreating Judas. It's his spirit. You know, you find that working in you. And so somebody goes, how can you put up with the people that come through there and do this thing? Oh, am I putting up with something? I mean, really, you know, because you're not putting up with something. You know, if you're living down here and counting, you know what I mean? If you're down here and you're counting, you're going, dang, you know, this is a losing proposition here. I can't seem to get anybody to rally around this thing here. It's been a lot of years, and, you know, I mean, but you realize that even if you never get anything in the natural, the B is still the same, and as long as you're in B, you're going to be all right. You know what I mean? Say, man, I've been a Christian 25 years and I've only learned two words, in B, and I'm okay. And I'm hoping it'll move. I want to move on down to know more of the Lord. But, you know, this is a pretty secure place right here, in B. It is. And if all things don't ever, through you, come into existence because of in B, we're jumping ahead. If you never get to see all those things happen because you may not be the channel, you may just be a little part of that straw, and it doesn't matter because that never was the real deal. Anyway, the real deal is right here. And I think all of us would like to see it manifested, but I think most of us, it's not really just the desire to see it manifested. It is, we're still so tied to the manifestation and have still seen so little of this that we need some kind of manifestation to keep us going. You know, some sort of a, I don't know. I just, you know, I mean, but you get to a place where, you know, it doesn't matter. I mean, it's settled. You're in the thing. You're in it. And this is what you're going to do. I mean, you see everything else as shadow is worthless in light of the treasure, so you know what you're about from now on. It has so taken the savor out of anything else. And in a way, you're really spoiled. I've used the word for me, I'm ruined. Once I saw this, I'm ruined. I knew from the time I saw it, my life would never be the same. And I said, I've seen the Lord. I've seen thee. And I know that I can never live for anything else. I can't. There's nothing else. Everything, if I live as a shadow of a carpenter or as a shepherd or as a, that, you see what I mean? Everything would just be a shadow. And it's ridiculous anyway. I mean, then you pick your shadow, brother. You know, and you're going, I don't think so. I think I'll live for the reality. He is the beginning, and if you have not yet seen him, you have not yet come to the knowledge of the beginning. Nobody wants to go back to the beginning. They don't want to start over. It means that you lose everything you've worked for. We don't like to begin again. Let me tell you, to begin again aright is good. I've had the Lord speak through me and even to me to people who say, now is the time to begin again. In fact, I wrote a tract on that. Or it's in one of those brochures or something. It says something like, now is the time to begin again, but this time in the Lord. This time, right. Nobody wants to go back. But if you're going back to the beginning, it's okay.
Well, you aren't really going back.
No, no, you're not. But that's the way we go.
As a perception, that's all. Because there's a lot of beginnings.
There's a lot of beginnings.
Because there's a lot of beginnings that we have to go through to get to the point, the point of the beginning. There's a lot of work God has to do in our lives. So if somebody is working to get to the beginning,
right,
then, you know, it's not
cool.
Discouraging. It's cool, but don't fool yourself either.
Well, the truth is, once you've done that, then all of a sudden you arrive at the beginning. If you truly arrive at the beginning, it's going to overwhelm you. You're going to say the same thing, my God, I just began.
That's right.
But, and there is this, there is part of you that just goes, I mean, you just be like, oh, what is all this been? But then there's this other part that goes, well, thank God, though, I feel better about than I ever have because I know this. So it's cool. You're absolutely right. In fact, I'm going to get into that. This clock will stop moving. Though when Israel had started, remember Israel left Egypt? Though when Israel had started, they had not yet begun. They wandered for years and miles. Sometimes we forget that. But we experience it. We weren't counting on that point. They wandered for years and miles in the wilderness and yet never entered the land. They could look back and say, look how far we've come. Remember what we went through and what God did for us, but they were no further than the first day they left Egypt. They were still in the wilderness. First day they stepped out of Egypt, they were in the wilderness. And the last day they stepped out of it, they were still in the wilderness. And there is no, the scriptures say this, and he sent Israel into the wilderness where there is no way. It's not true, there is no true spiritual progress in the wilderness. Now, it may be necessary to get you to a point, but it's not what we call spiritual progress. See, a lot of times it's tearing down more than it's building up. They hadn't even begun the place where God was trying to get them. Okay, so let's go back to the statement Al made about, you know, you've not really started over. I wrote this. You never leave the beginning. You never leave the beginning. You don't begin and then leave the beginning. This is important. A lot of people messed up because they leave the beginning. The beginning guides your way for the rest of your life. It guides your way for the rest of your life. The beginning is a memorial. Do you remember when Israel finally entered the land? What did they set up? They set up a memorial. What is the purpose of the memorial? To remember. And you remember the significance of the memorial? Death, burial, and resurrection. You never leave that beginning. You never leave it. In fact, it becomes the way you operate in the land. It is the law of the land. It really is. But it's not the law of the wilderness. It's the law of the land. Promise. Not the land of earning. Stop that clock. It's not something you leave, but you carry with you from now on. It's kind of like the cross. You never leave it. You go back to the word did. Cross and he. You never leave Jesus. You never leave the cross. Now, that I could wax eloquent for a while on that little subject, but this little. We have people here who are trying to see the cross so they can get it behind them. And they really don't understand. The cross is a way of life. It is the nature of God.
It is life.
It is life. It is. It is the life. It is the Lamb. It is all that we can understand. But for us, the cross is something we have to bear for a while, which really isn't the cross at all. That's what we call training around here. So we say, I have to bear this cross, which is nothing but training, for a while. But once I've borne the cross and have my training, oh, yay for the day. And that ain't even close. That ain't even the cross, much less.
I think it's the way the flesh sees itself into thinking that's one of our examples. Because I taught myself to, and I've had people say something to me, well, I just know God's in the flesh and you shouldn't put up with this. I don't say that you're not going to do anymore. I'm saying to him because I explained that there are certain things that we do as a whole, it doesn't matter. Some people, you know, if some of us are right, some of us are self-living selfishly, there's certain things that God's not going to move on until we're all moving together. And like, why is this God's in the flesh? You've been doing this for a long time, and I mean, I've been doing this myself, so I'm not like down, but just the principle that, no, you don't understand. It's not what it is. Like, I put this for a certain amount of time, and God blessed it, and my pain now. I haven't had these problems anymore. This is the way it is because you're joined to a body. Like, you know, you live in your life because you're joined to a body. You're joined to somebody good, you know, it doesn't matter. If one's wrong, you're all wrong. If one's looking selfish, it doesn't matter. You're all going to wait for that person. You know, right? And I mean, this is a real dish. I'm coming to you, I'm just like, well, let me tell you, you know. But, that's one of those people had to wait for. But, you know, now it's even because we're actually waiting for others. Well, what's wrong with you? I guess God doesn't need for being patient. It's that same thing as that individual mentality. So you give the cross, you will always wait. You will always go down the line. You will always, it's not, I did this type of idiot, so I won't have to. That's the way it is. That's what it's like.
Well, the Lamb always gives himself the just and the unjust. We don't. So we say, then it must be a situation of, if I do this for a certain period of time, God will bless me and take me out of this situation. Yeah, and we think that's the cross. And that's actually training, but we're not truly even being trained.
Not
the right stuff. It's so scary, that concept, because, it's not even in the land. It's not even in the kingdom type mentality.
It's another flesh thinks that it is. You know,
Well, maybe even, you know, I is probably right, but I'll be wrong in one sense. Maybe our spirit thinks it is. But it's really not our spirit that's going with that. But we're sincere. I think there's sincere people that have believed this kind of thing. But you couldn't be open to, I call it a deception, because it is. You couldn't be open to a deception like that unless your flesh wanted certain things and you had put it before you did. And that's really the truth. Now, you know, and only the people that will accept that, look straight in the face and go, you know, that's a fact, that's true of me, will get the victory. And those who won't will wander in the wilderness and think that they're in the land.
Scary.
Well,
that's
I would
scary.
Hate that. But, you know, I mean, to me, I'd rather drop instantly in the wilderness than wander for 40 years. You know, think that I'm okay or I'm not. Great.
Well, I still think one of the very things that shows the history here, and we wanted to share with them the real specific element that this farmer elephant was in an event for them to look at 30 years, farmer back on 30 years from now, talk about how great it was. The Lord was trying to establish something, but now that they were supposed to carry in their life that 30 years from now, he should be still working. Not just, well, we got through that, that was great. Well, that was great, you know. But the Lord's trying to establish something in them, which is the operative word there.
Right.
You know. And that it's supposed to become a part of their being that's in them. Keep continuing to move for them. Helps.
It's a bad question to teach from the windows that you're constantly a reason to place. Which word was I on? They that lack the beginning don't have the middle or the end. They think they do, but they really don't. If you leave the beginning to get to the middle, then you must start over. You don't leave it, you carry it with you. If the beginning were one thing and the end something else, like a foot race, you might might have to leave it. But he who is the beginning is also the end. So you cannot leave it. You can never leave. If this is it, here's the beginning, here's the end, and it's from A to Z, Christ, and you start anywhere along this line, it is both beginning and end, Alpha, Omega, and everything in between. You understand? So you can never truly, and I think once you're in this, once you're in it, you can't ever leave the beginning. There's just no way. You see what I'm saying? He is from everlasting to everlasting. As he was, so he will be. We never leave nor forget the humble beginnings and the nail scars after we've gathered around the glory of the throne. So here's the cross, and here's the throne, you know, we're sitting around the throne going, oh man, you know, thank God that ain't a factor anymore. Well, who are we worshiping? Who are we looking at? The Lamb of God. We see the nail scars. This is a symbol of the way that he is. He is a lamb. Jesus will never be that. He says, Can I forget you? You have been engraved on the palms of my hands. How am I ever going to forget you? You know, every time he does pets, ministers, anything that he does, there's always and forever the reality of that. But it is more than a physical manifestation, because it really is. The foundation of this thing is the beginning. The ending is simply the manifesting of that which was from the beginning. We're jumping way ahead to 1 John now. But 1 John begins this way. That which was from the beginning, we have seen. He's way on down in the pattern from the beginning. And what's he referring to? The beginning is captivated in and makes it his everything from now on. He's beginning and end from now on. As he was, so will he be. The beginning is never forgotten, though the end is being realized. This is hard, because if the manifestation of the thing is what we're after, then once you get to where it starts manifesting, you will have every reason to forget the beginning. But if the beginning is the reason for the manifestation for you, then you can never leave the beginning. The only thing that gives the manifestation or the end meaning to you is that you know from whence it came, where it came. And you cherish where it came more than what's coming back. Does that make sense? I mean, and so that is the truth that makes this have meaning. Not, oh, thank God, boy, everything's going rosy now. I mean, this is going to happen. This is so cool. You know, and you check your Bible of all the men who forgot their beginnings, that a prophet didn't have to come back later on, and it's more than one, and say, you forgot your beginning. You forgot where you started from. When you started, you saw the Lord, and you were humble and everything, but now you're getting the manifestation, and you feel real good. But you left your first love. You left your first. You left the beginning. You've gotten up, and so now you're enjoying this, and it's causing you to be full of pride. Well, let me tell you, if you ever look at the, and you continue with the beginning, then when it starts manifesting in the end, there's no more pride. There's no more, I'm better than you, or I don't have to put up with this. You know, I'll put up with that, whatever you want, as long as I can be by you. As long as I can be in you, of you. The beginning is never forgotten, though the end is being realized. Though it is a glorious kingdom and a glorious throne, yet he that is seated on it is still and always the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. And it is a glorious kingdom, and it is a glorious throne. It is glorious. There's no question about it. but forever the one that is head of that is the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. Jesus is the beginning and the end, so we are in the beginning in Christ. Once you see him, the fear of the Lord is the beginning. The scripture, the fear of the Lord is the beginning. Knowledge. Jesus said, I am the beginning and the end. Before anything was made, he was the beginning. Because all things are made by him, part of the fear from the law.